Now, I would like to point out that in recent years, the resolution of these 3D meshes have gone from tens of thousands of vertices to hundreds of thousands of vertices, and even recently, millions of vertices. And in their raw state, it is very difficult to handle these meshes. It is very difficult to store and transmit these 3D meshes. So compression, and more importantly, scalable compression, is very, very important to enable a very easy handling and storing and transmission of these highly detailed multimedia structures. Now, in 3D meshes, subdivision is a process to go from a quartz mesh to a fine, smooth mesh, which has high number of vertices. And I have shown here, it is acquired by a repetitive application of this subdivision process. And how this subdivision works is that we take our original mesh, and then we introduce new vertices at the midpoint of each of its edges. And then we introduce new edges to connect these newly introduced vertices. And then at the end, we do some kind of averaging to adjust the position of these white vertices based on the position of these old quartz vertices. And if we do this process again and again, we see we can go till we achieve a smooth, high-resolution mesh. Now, subsampling is the inverse process of subdivision, and which works such that we go from a fine mesh to a quartz mesh. And how it is done is that we first identify the vertices that we want to throw away. You see that in each main triangle, we have identified three vertices that we want to throw away. And then we physically remove these vertices and their associated edges to go from a fine mesh to a quartz mesh. And the same I have done here on this bunny mesh. And you see that we can throw away a lot more information. We can still keep the geometry. And of course, if we throw a lot more information, we introduce a lot of distortion, and geometry is distorted, let's say. So I would like to point out one main aspect is that the subsampling, the way I have explained here, it is only possible if your fine mesh have a certain kind of a connectivity. And this connectivity, in theory, is known as subdivision connectivity. That means that the connectivity of this fine mesh can be exactly predicted by using the connectivity of this coarse mesh and some kind of a subdivision scheme. And if the mesh stick to this definition, it is called semi-regular mesh. And in practice, semi-regular meshes are actually not acquired directly. Original meshes are irregular. However, you can convert an irregular mesh to a semi-regular mesh, making use of some kind of a remeshing technique. So we'll be discussing about semi-regular meshes, highly detailed semi-regular meshes. So in practice, for scalable compression of these highly detailed semi-regular meshes, we use wavelet transform or multi-resolution analysis. How it works, we take the original semi-regular mesh, and we go to a quartz mesh using subsampling, as I just explained. And then for vertices that are present in this mesh, but they are not present in this mesh, we create prediction using some kind of a subdivision. So subdivision can be different kinds. I'm not going to the details of subdivision itself. So, but for these vertices for which we have created the prediction, we can record the prediction error in the form of a vector, and we call it the subband, yeah, or high frequency subband. And we can do the same process again on this this low resolution mesh, and we can create another resolution subband. Yeah, and we can keep repeating this process till we end up with a number of subbands and a coarse mesh geometry known as the base mesh. Now, of course, these two components can be put together in the inverse transform to reconstruct our original semi-regular mesh because the wavelet transform is lossless. Now, how we are going to do the scalable compression of these semi-regular meshes? We are going to do no quantization of this base mesh. We are going to save it losslessly. And we are going to do scalable quantization of these prediction errors, which are also called wavelet coefficients. Yeah? And scalable quantization, as the way I explained before, we code it in a bit plane by bit plane fashion. Now, in lossy source compression, it is very important to know the statistics of your signal. And moreover, it is also very important to know the rate distortion behavior of your signal under embedded quantization or under any kind of quantization. And traditionally, the generalized Gaussian distributions are used to approximate the histograms of wavelet coefficients in the wavelet decomposed structure of a mesh. Now, they can approximate the histograms very accurately, but they have a slight problem that due to their complicated formulations, the rate distortion behavior under embedded quantization is not tractable. So this motivated us to propose a more simpler solution, but it was novel, as I'll explain later, its contributions actually. And here we see that we have proposed a novel Laplacian mixture model, which, as shown by this equation, is just a linear combination of two Laplacian PDFs. And due to its simplicity, now we can compute the ray distortion behavior exactly, and that I did compute in my thesis. I'll not go into the details of this because it involves a lot of mathematics. But for illustrative purposes, I have shown here the two Laplacian PDFs. The blue one is the low variance Laplacian PDF, while the green one is the high variance Laplacian PDF. And this is the linear summation or linear combination of these two PDFs, this red curve. And you see that this red curve, which is the linear combination, it keeps its sharp decay property of this blue PDF till these intersection points. And afterwards, it inherits the more flat nature of this green PDF. So here I have shown or compared the histogram approximation performance of the proposed Laplacian mixture model against generalized Gaussian model and the single Laplacian model for this dyno mesh. And the blue bars here are the experimentally observed histogram. And we see here that this red curve actually closely follows this experimentally observed histogram. Actually, it follows it more closely than this black or this green curve. And we have observed the same similar behavior for other kind of meshes also when we compared our performance to generalized Gaussian or single Laplacian models. And here in this slide, I have shown the distortion rate modeling performance of the Laplacian mixture model against the other two models for the same dyno mesh. I have plotted the distortion versus the rate. And again, you see that this red curve, which is the Laplacian mixture model, it closely follows this blue experimentally observed curve more closely than either black or this green curve. And again, we have observed similar behavior for other meshes also. And now we can safely conclude that the proposed Laplacian mixture model has a better histogram fitting, and yet it also gives, and of course, it also gives a better distortion rate fitting than the commonly used generalized Gaussian schemes. Now we have modeled our signal, histograms, but still we need to find out what is the optimal embedded quantization strategy we should use for our signal. And we have performed a novel model-based analysis here also, and the model was, of course, our Laplacian mixture model. And we concluded that what kind of strategy we should use for optimal embedded quantization. I'll not go into the details again for this analysis that we performed, but I'll present the conclusions of my analysis. And we found out that the optimal embedded quantization strategy should be the one that have equal size bins. Yeah, you see, bins are equal size. Yeah, on different levels, of course, they have changed their size, but on one level, all the bins are of same size. The exception is this central bin, which is symmetrically distributed around the mean value, and it is called the dead zone bin. And this dead zone bin should be twice the size of the normal cells. You see here, it is 8 delta, while the other cell have 4 delta size. And then this property should be kept constant throughout all the embedded levels. In practice, such a quantization scheme, in theory, it is known as successive approximation quantization, and we'll be making use of this successive approximation quantization in our design of scalable compression systems. Now, the original aim of the wavelet transform was to perform decorrelation of spatial domain data, but we know that transforms are not often perfect, so there might still be statistical dependencies between the wavelet coefficients in a decomposed structure of a mesh. And in meshes, there are three kinds of statistical dependencies: the interband dependencies, the intraband dependencies, and the composite dependencies. The interband dependencies are the dependencies between the wavelet coefficients of different resolution subbands, while the intraband dependencies are the dependencies between the wavelet coefficient of the same resolution subband. And the composite dependencies are the hybrid of both interband and intraband dependencies. Now we have computed the mutual information for all three kind of dependencies through a novel analysis that we performed. And our analysis revealed that in the wavelet decomposed structure of a mesh, the interband dependencies are the weakest form of dependencies, while the intraband dependencies are more stronger than interband dependencies, and the composite dependencies are much more stronger than both interband or interband dependencies. Now, this analysis reveals that if we want to design an efficient compression system for meshes, we should probably go with intraband dependencies. And if our computational complexity allows us, we should go for the composite dependencies because they are the best. But I would like to point out that the state-of-the-art compression system employ these interband dependencies, which, as revealed by our analysis, are the weakest form of dependencies. So by now we know a lot about our signal, which were these subbands. We know what are the histograms of these subbands, what are the statistical properties. We know what kind of embedded quantization scheme we should use. We know what kind of statistical dependencies we should exploit. And we put together all this knowledge that we have acquired through different analyses. And we have designed two scalable compression systems for semi-regular meshes. First one is the intra-band SIM compression system, or SIM codec. And the second one is the 3XC composite codec. How we did it, we simply took our signal, the subband, and we do the embedded quantization. And then using the quad-tree bit plane coding, we coded this subband in a bit plane by bit plane fashion, such that every subband is handled independently of all other subbands. And then the coded bit stream for each subband are further compressed using context adaptive arithmetic coding, and then bit stream formulation is done. And the base mesh is actually losslessly coded and is embedded into the bit stream. So now I'm going to explain what are the scalability features of our proposed coding architectures. We have two scalability modes. The first one is the quality scalability mode, and it works such that if you receive more and more data, and if you receive more and more bit planes, you refine the quality of your compressed signal. And the red color here shows the error with respect to the original mesh, and we see that as we go further in the rate, or we decode more and more bit planes, we receive higher quality and the mesh becomes more and more green. Now, this quality scalability mode is the mode that is available in our coding systems also and in the state-of-the-art compression system as well. Now, the second scalability mode is the resolution scalability mode, and which works such that if we receive more and more rate or more and more bit planes, we actually refine the resolution of our compressed mesh. I would like to point out that, this resolution scalability mode that we have, it's not present in the state-of-the-art compression systems, and it was enabled by our coding architectures. And this is a very important scalability feature because this allows the decoding of high-resolution meshes on terminals that have limited resolution capabilities. So it is a very, very important scalability feature that was enabled by our coding frameworks. Now, here I have integrated a demo for scalable decoding of this skull mesh. And you see again that if we receive more and more data, we can reconstruct better quality. And due to its scalable nature, you can stop the decoding process any point in time, and you can reconstruct an intermediate quality of the mesh. And here I have shown the reconstruction in the wireframe. You see, again, the vertices and the edges, they refine as you receive more and more rate. And here I have shown it with the color. The red color shows the error with respect to the original input mesh. And you see as we receive more and more, decode more and more data or rate, we reconstruct the green mesh. So here I have shown the 3D view. And of course, other things follow accordingly. So here I have compared the performance of our proposed architecture 3XC against the progressive geometric compression system of Caltech, which was the state-of-the-art compression system when we started implementing or designing our coding systems. And the results are shown here at a rate of 0.05 bits per vertex. And we see that at the same rate, we can do much better actually compared to this contemporary scheme. We have much less red color in our decoded mesh. And the red color, as I said, is the error, shows the error with respect to the original mesh. Actually, visually, you can also see that, this mouth area, for example, is represented in a much better way than here when you compare it to the original input mesh. Yeah? And here we have improvement of around 1.9 dBs. We have observed similar improvements, sometime more, sometime less, in all different meshes, normal or non-normal. And now we can conclude that since our coding architectures enable two things, first is that they have a new scalability mode. They have enhanced the scalability of the bitstream, the resolution scalability mode. And since they can perform better compression than the existing state-of-the-art design, we can claim that now we have a state-of-the-art, new state-of-the-art in scalable mesh compression of semi-regular meshes.